Good morning, everybody. My name is Derek Howell, and I want to welcome you as one of the ministers here at Fairymeadow Anglican, who knew Audrey well. I want to welcome you this morning as we've gathered together for the day that we knew was coming. And so we do so with gratitude to God, as well as grieving our loss of dear Audrey. On behalf of Leonie and Mark and Richard and Janet and their families, thank you so much for coming and expressing your love for Audrey by being here to support them in this time. We also want to welcome those who have joined us via the live stream, and I understand there are people in Europe and other parts, I was going to say other parts of Australia, but in far-flung parts of Australia, and we're delighted that you're able to join us for this time together. I know that in the building this morning, as we gather in this way, there are many friends of Audrey's from her Christian family here at Fairymeadow. When I first came here 8 years ago, she was a regular member of our early morning church, very much loved and appreciated because you always knew when you spoke with her that she wasn't trying to get something out of you. She was always trying to give. And she, as all of you know, a wonderful example of somebody who was always interested and looking for the best in other people. All of us in the room this morning have been impacted by her love, and that is perhaps the primary thing for which we give thanks, expressed in so many ways to her family, but also her very wide circle of friends and neighbours as well. We do feel the sadness of her passing, but that is mixed with a sense of relief that her suffering is now over, and we gather with a sense of certainty as to where she is now, and therefore, because of her Lord and Saviour, we rejoice that she is now with him. So what we are sharing this morning can best be put in these words taken from the prayer book, which Audrey was very familiar with. We've come together this morning, friends, to thank God for the life of Audrey Hollins, to mourn and to honour her, to lay to rest her mortal body, and to support one another in our grief. We face the certainty of our own death and judgment. But like Audrey, those who die in Christ share eternal life with him. And therefore, in faith and hope, we turn to God, who created and sustains us all. I want to read now a couple of verses from the Bible, which from which that statement really is taken. The first one comes from the book of Ecclesiastes in the Old Testament, and may sound an unusual thing to say, but we'll recognize it as being reality. In chapter 7 of that book, we read, "A good name is better than fine perfume, and the day of death better than the day of birth. It is better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting, for death is the destiny of everyone, and the living should take this to heart." What God says is that it is very wise to be here today to face the reality of death. The Lord Jesus Christ was one who reminded us again and again of the certainty of death and the even greater certainty of his own conquering of death. So in speaking to the dear sister of his closest friend, Lazarus, he says, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me will live, even though they die, and whoever lives and believes in me will not die eternally. Friends, I invite you now to bow your heads as I lead us in prayer. God, our Father, you alone are holy. Forgive us all our sins and failures. Uphold us by your Spirit now. Enable us to show your compassion. Give us in our sorrow the calm of your peace and comfort us in our grief. We ask this prayer through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Audrey lived an ordered life, and she gave orders about her funeral as well. And so we're going to follow orders, and she has chosen two hymns for us to sing. The first one is a version of Psalm 23, and the words are printed there on your order of service. The King of Love, my shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. I invite you to stand and we'll sing. Sit down. We're now going to hear some tributes to our dear sister, and firstly, Leonie Ruth and Mark are going to speak to us. Oh, Mark is coming first.
Hello, everybody. I'm Mark, I'm Audrey's second eldest child. When I was thinking about what I might say today and thinking about my mum's life, very quickly, sort of about four or five simple things just came to mind straight away. without too much deep reminiscing or hard thinking, and I thought to myself, I'll stick with those. So, and what came to mind firstly was that she was a great mum. She was very loving and supportive. We'll miss her greatly. All the attributes of a great mum she had in spades, and we all loved her dearly and we'll miss her. Secondly, she was smart. I realised very early she was smarter than me. When she started her work career, she was an English history teacher. When she married Dad, due to the rules of the Department of Education at the time, if you were a woman and you were a teacher and you got married, you had to stop working. So she stopped working and had four kids. I remember she went back to work. I think it was when I was in high school. She also went back to university as a mature age student and did a Lit B, or Bachelor of Letters, which is like a master's in literature, and wrote a novel on the role of houses. She wrote a thesis on the role of houses in the novels of Henry James. Nice and light topic. Her work included going to England and checking out all of Henry James' houses. Needless to say, she did very well. And, you know, she remained certainly smarter than me her whole life. And, yeah, she was a very clever lady. Secondly, she was funny. She loved to laugh and joke. She had a great sense of humour and a cheeky sense of humour. When we were growing up, she was always loved to watch comedy shows, whether it be Mavis Bramston's show, Morecambe and Wise, Dave Allen, Auntie Jack. She was addicted to the Benny Hill show. Slightly dodgy, but that's the way it was. And the whole life, she just had this great sense of humour. Next, she was sporty. She went to Parramatta High. In her senior years, she just won all the running races. She was a very good sprinter. She played tennis her whole life. She belonged to a now famous walking group, many of you here today, when she had lots of coffee. She loved watching sport. When we were growing up, she loved watching rugby league with us. But if any of the players made a break or looked like scoring a try, she would just get so excited, she would start shrieking and squealing to the point where the rest of us would be in the corner of the room going, "Mum, get a grip, this is so embarrassing." Next, in terms of musical ability, we're a musical family. I think my mum probably had music ability, but she never got the chance to explore it or exercise it. But she knew how to make kids practice. And she made the four of us practice to the point where we're all competent musicians, and that's something that stayed with us our whole lives. So that's they're the things that came to mind and things I wanted to mention. And I miss my mum. I thank you all for coming here today. And I'll hand over now to my older sister, Leonie Ruth. Thank you.
I did do a lot of thinking and agonising, but I probably won't be nearly as funny as my brother. 97 years and 8 months is a very long time to live. There was a lot of life and a lot of love packed into that. And the fact that you are all here today is testimony to the quality of the life and love. Each and every one of you touched her lives and she was touched by you. I want to focus on a couple of other attributes that weren't covered off. Audrey was a lifelong learner. From the age of five, she wanted to learn to knit, and her mother advised her that it was far too dangerous for a five-year-old to be left with knitting needles. So Audrey, not wanting to distress her elders, took herself under the house, got some knitting needles and some wool, and taught herself to knit in the dark under the house. Presumably what you can't see can't hurt you. She knitted all her life. In fact, had a beautiful relationship with Vanessa Woodhill, who provided Audrey with fleece from her farm in Goulburn, and Audrey would knit a jumper for Vanessa's family and a jumper for our family, and I have one of those jumpers still in my wardrobe. Her lifelong learning continued through her love of crossword and quizzes, and when she lived with us in Bungendore, she hadn't done the quizzes before, but we did the crosswords at breakfast, and we started doing the quizzes at lunchtime. No, she didn't like the quiz, thank you very much. We'd do it anyway, and then all of a sudden, this answer would pop out. We'd turn to mum and say, hang on, you don't like the quiz, and time and time again. Finally, to cut a long story short, she really loved the quiz and got really good at it and provided, I think, the square root of some question? 260 something, and Audrey just went, and the question was asked, and we were in a family gathering, and there was silence until Audrey just said 19. And I remember William, who's here, said, how did you know that? Oh, she said, I learned it at school, of course. She was a voracious reader, and it was testimony to her lifelong learning that when she came to Bungendore during lockdown, we enticed her to go onto Kindle, where she could delight in choosing her own books, and then when the library reopened, that became one of her many happy places. She managed to read all the non-fiction and biography books in Bungendore Library, and I had to suggest that maybe they cycled some of the books through from the Queanbeyan Library so Audrey had a bit more reading material. They kindly obliged. Her teaching continued in a variety of forms, not the least being the migrant English classes she was involved with, and for 17 years, and I'm not sure whether this is actually credit to her teachers in English, but perhaps more to her credit as a social bonder, she taught the same group of women for 17 years, and they obviously enjoyed her company and each other's company, and we'd often get warm pizza delivered to us because some of the Italian ladies were passing by and wanted to teach to have some, which was lovely. She also had a teaching role in her Bible study group, and when I met with Derek, he said that he was really quite surprised at the particular Bible study format that she was using. He said that was actually designed for university students. And I think the corollary there was not octogenarians, but well done octogenarians, I say. That Bible study group was very, very special to Audrey, and we have beautiful joy here today from that group. Jackie has sent her apologies. She couldn't be with us. I was visiting in Wollongong on one occasion when they had their meeting, and at the end of, I was doing other things, at the end of the meeting, all of a sudden, this beautiful singing happened. And I peeked around and there they were holding hands, singing the doxology together. It was a very moving and special moment. Audrey was highly organised. To have four children back in the day and a husband who had to do a lot of travelling, you needed to be organised. I think she was the original minimalist, and she single-handedly wanted to get rid of any clutter in her house, if not the world. And the combination of those two things was that each of our four children were colour-coded. So our toothbrushes, our mugs, our plates, our face washers, our towels were all colour-coded. Mine was green, Mark's was blue, Richard. What was your colour, Richard? Yellow? And Janet was? Ingrained upon our souls. I was actually a little bit jealous because Jana had the pink. However, I have to say green's my favourite colour now, so that's all good. So that was one of the many examples of Audrey's great efficiency. She was a great cook, and that went with her love of hospitality, whether it was neighbours, and we have beautiful Betty Moody and Don and Nicia Queen here today, who were neighbours when we moved into Mount Ousley, came over at Christmas time, dropped in for cups of tea. And Audrey had some specialties which were very well known. So her hospitality extended not only to neighbours and friends but to her family and to grandchildren. And as the grandchildren will tell you, Grandma Audrey's chocolate chip cookies and lemon passion fruit dessert were legendary. And as anybody else will probably tell you, her Dutch ginger cake was much favoured. And as I was telling Lorna, who's in charge of the catering here today, a few years ago when I went to visit my son, who is in Amsterdam, so a shout out to you, Dan, as you listen in, I took a frozen Dutch ginger cake. I figured that if I froze it and it could go in the cargo, then by the time it got to Amsterdam, it would be defrosted, ready to eat, which it was. We heated up, warmed it slightly, and his Dutch friends were delighted. They'd never seen anything like it, but it is called a Dutch ginger cake. The recipe now circulates through Amsterdam. Audrey's love of people extended to not just those she was related to and immediately friends with by proximity or otherwise, but to people in the community with need. And in the late 70s, early 80s, I think it was, this church had a migrant support group, I think it was called. And Audrey had no less than, I think it was three families that she connected with very strongly. And we have Marie-Louise here today and Irene, who were very, very special to her. She, in her qualities to her family and her friends and everyone she met, one of the outstanding qualities was loyalty. And right through to very, very recently, she's had so much beautiful connections with people whose lives she had touched. And I had a phone call from the son of one of the families just about 4 weeks ago. And he said, I didn't have any grandmas left in Serbia. He said, but I always thought of Audrey as my grandma here in Australia, which was lovely. Audrey loved people. She also loved animals, cats and dogs. You probably don't know, but we in fact had two tortoises as pets. And there was a bath, I think, or something sunken down below our veranda, and Audrey go out morning and night and make a particular noise which the tortoises respond to and stuck their heads out of the pond looking for the bits of mince she'd throw down. Audrey wasn't very creative. They were called tortoise and tortio, but the tortoise didn't take that amiss at all. That was okay. When she stayed with us in Bungendore, she absolutely delighted in the bird life there, and she sat in the warmth of the conservatory watching the avian slideshow, as it were, all day. She really loved it. She said, oh, no, I saw that magpie yesterday. Oh, what do you think that such and such a bird is doing? I said, I don't know, Mum. You're the one that looks at them all the time. She loved to travel. And a little animal story from when she travelled with Dan and Harry's father, who's here today. We were in the Ngorongoro Crater in Tanzania, and we had a guide, and he said to Patrick, now, when this rhino starts charging, when I say stop, cut the engine. So sure enough, this rhino sights us, and rhinos, compared to a Land Rover, about, I don't want to exaggerate, about four times the size and height, and the rhino starts charging. There's dust everywhere, and Audrey says to Rod, Rod, could you wind up the window, please? And I thought, we've got a great big can opener coming towards us, and you're worried about the window being open. But in fact, the instruction was given, cut, and the engine was cut, and the rhino sauntered off. And the guide said to me, so would you like, do you get enough pictures? Would you like to do that again? I'm like, no, we don't need any more pictures. No, thank you. She had many opportunities to travel. One was to Fiji, where she and Dad helped rebuild a school that had been demolished by a cyclone. She went on official trips with Dad representing the University of Wollongong to Beijing, which is where she was when my second son, Harry, was born. And then at age 85, where this photo that was up there was taken, she came with David and I to visit Daniel and Harry, who were doing postgraduate study at Oxford at the time. And that was a really special visit. At 85, she rocked it. She arrived and we went from the airport in Heathrow straight up to Norfolk, where a lot of her family were, and attended a family reunion. She sat there and held her first cousin Christine's hand for the whole of the afternoon, and the family buzzed around. One of the family members has a wife from Bangladesh, and there were some Bangladeshi women there too. Audrey was just in her element, having stepped off of a 24-hour long-haul flight. Go figure. She was, one mighty tough lady. Friends, and here I want to know that if I don't mention your name, that's on me, not on Audrey. She kept in touch with people all her life, from people she went to university with to people that were part of her first church community up in Heathcote, to people that were part of the church community here when she moved to Bungendore, and you kept in touch with her. She made new friends very late in life, and one of them was Jonathan, who visited her very regularly at Warrigal. She has very faithful church friends, Nancy and Jean and Beverly Defty, who visited her so faithfully. She has the beautiful Heather Nash, who corresponded with her and rang her on her birthday every year. And she'd say, hello, Auntie Audrey, who is it? And she'd say, I know, it's my birthday, it's you, Heather. And thank you for coming today, Heather. She had the Bible study ladies, who I've mentioned, and there were various iterations of that group. But I will also add that not only did they study the Bible, but on public holidays, they gathered together and had fish and chips, which was quite a thing. I was a bit jealous where I lived because I didn't have fish and chips or a group to gather with on a public holiday. So those ladies were rocking it. She belonged to many social groups, including the tennis group, and we have Barbara Rixon here today from the tennis group, and I think I see Jenny Lightbody as well. Beautiful, faithful ladies all her life. And you ladies were very special to her because you accepted her into Wollongong when we first moved down, and that's a really special thing to have that acceptance and social grouping immediately upon arrival. And then there's the St. Michael's Walking Ladies, and I don't know if they have any other more not nomenclature than that, but you were a part of her later life, and as I said, not only walking but coffee, but also, and this was really, really special, the cards that you would each sign with a special message about prayer and sending her love. You sent them all through her time at Bungendore with me and then when she was in nursing home. And even though many of you couldn't get to see her in person, that card was read over and over again. There were multiple cards. And the family was like, oh, there's another card from the Walking Ladies. Little touches like that just were so special and meant so much to Audrey. And thank you, Lynn Kendrick, for organising that. And then there was her very special friend, Emma. Emma, many of you probably have not met her, but Emma visited Audrey so faithfully and regularly. She helped her with her hair. She helped her with her personal hygiene. She knitted her the most beautiful jumpers that she wore. Emma was an embodiment of what a best friend and love can be. And I know it's going to be particularly tough on you, Emma, because Audrey was a day-to-day part of your life. And thank you very much for being the beautiful lady you are. So, family. Oh, here we go. I don't really need to say all that much about family. You know who we are. You know who you are. And you know how much you were loved by Audrey. I have to say, I think she set the bar extremely high for grandmothers, and I'm feeling the pinch rather now. She was a damn good grandma. I haven't quite perfected chocolate chip cookies yet, but maybe Nina and Felix, her great-grandchildren, her bonus great-grandchildren, can get me onto that, or maybe we can teach you the recipe. As Mark said, Audrey was a woman of great intelligence. She was a woman of great integrity. She was a woman of great faith. Your lives touched her deeply, and she was very, I'm sure that you feel that in connecting with her, you were touched as well. And it can only be said that Audrey, indeed, you have a life well lived. Thank you.
Thank you so much for those tributes and sharing so much of Audrey's life with us. I mentioned that she did fill in one of our funeral planners, which gives great help to family when they're planning someone's funeral. But when it came to the next point, that is music to be played, the family will decide. Is what she wrote. So she didn't choose the two pieces that we're about to enjoy, but I want to invite firstly Karina and Dominic up to play, and then Leonie, Ruth and David to do so after them.
Thank you. Audrey loved a good musical, and she used to go up every year, I think it was, with the Tennis Ladies, and they'd go to a musical in Sydney. And this is why I chose this piece, and also because I'd like you to be able to augment and amplify our memories together and keep Audrey in our hearts.
We come now to hear the two Bible passages that Audrey asked be read at her funeral. And I'm going to ask two of her granddaughters, Holly and Phoebe, to come up and share in the reading of Isaiah 40, verse 28 and following, and then for Richard to come and read from Romans chapter 8.
Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will not walk and not be faint.
Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger of sword. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Why did Audrey choose those two passages? You might say because they're very short and she was having mercy on us. But they're striking passages, and I don't really quite know why she chose them, but as I've looked into them a bit more deeply, I think the reason becomes very obvious. The first one is probably written about 700 BC by the Old Testament prophet Isaiah, one of the greatest of the prophets in the Old Testament. At this particular time, he is a member of the people of Israel, the Israelites, immensely privileged in being the only nation out of all the earth that God chose to be his own people. He promised them through their forefather Abraham that they would live under his rule in a land that he would give them, and he would make them prosper. It would be a most wonderful existence of peace, stability, of good, of gratitude, of contentment, of all those things that human beings desire and more. And all coming to them, not because they deserved it in any way whatsoever, but because God is the kind of God that he is, the kind of God that Audrey knew him to be, generous beyond measure. All they had to do in response to this goodness was to follow God's lead wholeheartedly. Perhaps what's required of them is summed up best in the Lord Jesus' summary of the commandments. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and your soul and your mind and your strength, and you shall love your neighbour as yourself. Jesus said, on these two commandments hang the whole of the Old Testament, the response that people are to give to our generous God. But we know that they struggled again and again in their history. They fell short. They did not put God first. They did not trust him. They tried to be like the other nations of the world who had visible gods. Their God was invisible. But really, the reason why they sinned against God, why they disobeyed him, why they went against so much of what he had said, was because they wanted independence, like we all do. We don't want anybody telling us what to do. These days, we don't want anybody telling us who we are. We are free agents, so we think, in charge of our own destiny. And that's exactly how the nation of the Israelites thought in 700 BC. The prophets, like Isaiah, warned them against doing this. It was a monstrous distortion of their responsibility, and yet they sought to be independent of him. It resulted in terrible depravity, in corrupt leadership, in religiosity rather than heart religion. And so by the time of Isaiah, we find the poignant words of Psalm 137, which some of you may be old enough to remember being on whatever they call the hit parade now. By the waters of Babylon, we sat down and wept when we remembered you, O Zion. Anyone sing it along with me? No. Terribly sad, for the people who'd been so blessed and so privileged at the hands of God, to be removed from all that, thinking they would never see it again. They would never be in the land of Israel. They'd never see the beautiful city, Jerusalem. They would never be in the presence of God again. And then along comes Isaiah, and not only answering or telling them what was going to happen because of their disobedience, but telling them that even in the midst of that, there was a great message of hope. Is it possible? Some of his hearers would say. Yes, 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 says Isaiah, because of who our God is, not because of who we are, but because of who our God is. I took the time to read through the whole of chapter 40, and I was singing the Messiah to myself as I went, because George Handel and the man who wrote the lyrics, Mr. Jennings, picked this passage of the Old Testament. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak comfortably to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare is ended. Again and again, chapter 40, climaxing in these verses, holds out the great promise of the future. They are to be filled with hope in the midst of their great suffering. And it's an interesting way in which he concludes this chapter, not that he actually wrote in chapters, that's us poor Anglo speakers, we have to divide the original up into chapters so we can find it. But he finishes by saying, have you not known, don't you remember what God is like? He is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He doesn't grow tired or weary. He's not going to make a promise to us and then get tired of it, like the gods of the nations, they thought, did. He is predictable. He will follow through on what he promises. And then there's this lovely picture. God doesn't grow weary. Even youths, some of us will call ourselves youths, and some of us can remember what it was like to be youths. Even youths, with all their strength, their power, their training, the gym, running around the oval, even youths grow tired and weary. We run out of puff, and young men stumble and fall. And I think this is why Audrey chose this particular passage as she aged. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. Macular degeneration will be gone. She'll have 20/20 vision. She'll be able to run again and perhaps make the 4-minute mile. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and they will not faint. They won't give up. They will have the strength to continue, the power to keep going, unlike in the present age when we just run out of puff. It's a strange way to talk about the future, but it's memorable. And it does speak of, if you like, perfection. Across the way, next to the parking area, is a gym. And occasionally we hear the music, if you can call it music, from the gym, as people pound away with their muscles, trying to strengthen them, trying to do better than they did last week so that they can show how buff they are, or they can run faster or swim faster. But there's a time coming when that's not going to be needed. And there are some in the congregation who would say, thank God for that. But a time of perfection, no more having to exercise. What does it mean? It is a picture of hope. a certainty that is coming without filling in the details too much, because God is always God. God is always the one who is true to his word. And how do we know that? Well, I think this is why Audrey chose the second passage from the end of the 8th chapter of the letter of the Apostle Paul to the Christians in Rome, written probably around about 550 or so AD. He has been explaining to people what he understands to be the way God has spoken and acted in history. And it all comes down to one word, Jesus. Jesus the Christ. Jesus, God's anointed King over the world. And he said some amazing things about the fact that people who behave like the people of Israel in the 7th century before then and since then can be forgiven. That those who know because of the way we have behaved that there's hell to pay can know that hell has been landed on the shoulders of Jesus on the cross. He is separated, if you like, from God. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? He is filled with anguish, sadness. And yet, that was God's way of making disobedient people right with himself. Justice demands that our rebellion against God must be paid for. And the wonderful news is not we can earn our forgiveness by going to church, doing good things, excelling at everything. No, no. He's done it for us. He has done all of it for us through the Lord Jesus Christ. But there's still a bit of a question. What happens when I suffer because I am Christian? What happens when I suffer? Does that mean God withdraws his love from me? Is this a sign that somehow I've gone too... No, says the Apostle Paul. Don't be filled with a separation anxiety. What shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No, he says. In all these things, it's as if we were victors over those things. In fact, not it seems as though we were. We are. Because of Jesus' victory, we face those things as Audrey faced many of those things, with confidence in God. And so the apostle finishes this by saying, I am convinced that neither death, remember we're gathered here together because our sister has experienced death, I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from that love of God in Jesus, in Christ Jesus, our Lord. That's why Audrey knew that the promise of Isaiah chapter 40 and the hundreds of other promises about the future that are both in Old Testament and New Testament was true. That's why she kept persevering, trusting God, even though her body was failing her, even though her eyesight had failed her. She knew God. She knew God through the Lord Jesus Christ. She was certain of what was going to happen. At the end of last year, I went with some friends to visit Audrey and a number of other former members of our congregation who are down at Warrigal. And we celebrated communion together. And that was lovely. It was just lovely. Audrey entered into the spirit of the thing. She knew the words off by heart. She didn't need a prayer book or anything like that. She knew it all. And then at the end, she dropped a clanger, which was an illustration to me of just how smart she was. Because as we're just sitting round talking, she suddenly said, "What do you think is the meaning of baptism? Should children be baptized?" I don't know where that came from, but everybody else in the room started discussing whether you could have infant baptism. She said, I don't think the Bible allows us or teaches us to have infant baptism. I didn't find out till last week that she actually was from a Christian Brethren background, and in that denomination they don't practice infant baptism. And then there was a retired clergyman in the room, and he said, yes, an Anglican clergyman who has to perform infant baptisms. And he said, yeah, I don't really think it's true either. I mean, it's a good thing to do, but really, it's not in the Bible. And so we had this spirited discussion about infant baptism. What on earth, you know, here I had gone to kind of bring some sort of comfort, strengthening, and we're off on this other tangent. And it just illustrated to me how cheeky she was, how clever she was, and how much she trusted her dear Saviour. So facing the people in the room, all at different distances from our deaths, and yet she could just continue on with a normal conversation. It was terrific. And all because she understood what the Lord Jesus Christ had done for her. I know that even though I didn't talk with her about these particular passages, but by choosing these ones for today, it's as if she is speaking from beyond the grave. She wants us to hear these. Out of love, she wants us to remember the great promises of God, of what the Bible calls the new heavens and the new earth, when everything is going to be right. There won't be any more mourning or crying or suffering or pain, because the old order of things will have gone away. And all because of Jesus, whose love is eternal, whose forgiveness is certain, whose death for us does everything, full stop, to bring us to God. Friends, I want to encourage you to think about Audrey, as if you wouldn't on today, but particularly about what she believed, what was at the very core of her being. Now we're going to join together in prayer, and Roger, our senior minister here, is going to lead us. The Lord's Prayer is printed on the back of the order of service.
We'll pray the Lord's Prayer in a few moments, but please bow your heads as we come before God. Heavenly Father, we recognize that you gave us life when you created us. And in your redeeming love, you've given us new life in Christ Jesus. And so today we give you thanks for your servant Audrey. In faith and trust, we leave her in your keeping through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, the one who died and rose again to save us, the one who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, in glory forever. Amen. Almighty God, Father of all mercies and giver of all comfort, we come before you today and ask that you would deal graciously, we pray, with all those who mourn, that casting all our care on you, we might know the consolation of your love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Father, we thank you particularly that your Son, the Lord Jesus, is one who is familiar with suffering, that he himself in his flesh and bones knows what it is to grieve the loss of a loved one. We thank you that you are the God of all comfort, who does not stand at a distance but comes close to us in our grief, who encourages us to cry out to you. We thank you that you've put in our hearts a longing for eternity, for justice, for compassion, for grief to be over. And we thank you that the resurrection of Jesus, that timely reminder of Audrey's passing on the Easter weekend, reminds us both of the depth of your love for us in the death of Christ, the perfection of your justice, but also the security of the future, which is grounded in the reality of Jesus' resurrection. And so, Father, we thank you that we can pray not just with grief, but also with hope. Father, as we thank you for one another, we thank you for Audrey's family. We thank you for Leonie, Ruth, and Mark, and Richard, and Janet, and their families. Thank you for the times that you have granted them with Audrey, for her joy and delight in being a person who loves your world, for being a great mum, for her cheekiness, for her discipline, for her generosity with her time for others. We thank you for the family that she and Rod created in your kindness. And we pray for her family and extended family that you might be their comfort as they grieve her loss, and that in time their grief might give way to joy in thankfulness for the person that you have made her and the way that she's influenced the people around her. Lord, we thank you that we can come before you with hearts that are open, recognizing that you know our grief and that you know our thankfulness for the people you've put around us. And so we pray that as the Father of all mercies and the giver of all comfort, you would help us to keep casting our cares on you. Today we thank you for the life of your servant Audrey, and we pray that you would preserve among us the good of her example. Keep us in the way of truth until we come to your eternal kingdom. And we trust, Lord, that you're the one in whose mighty power it lies to bring good out of evil, to bring joy out of grief, to raise up life from the dead. We ask that you would give us a patient faith in times of darkness, that you would enlighten our understanding with the knowledge of your ways through Jesus Christ our Lord. And we ask that in all these days, the days that seem long in this troublesome life, until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes, when this busy world is hushed and the fever of life is over, when our work is done, then, Lord, in your mercy, grant us a safe lodging, a rest with you, peace at the last. We can ask these things only because of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let's pray the prayer that Jesus has taught us together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our next hymn speaks of a certainty about the future, which is grounded in the grace that God has already shown us. Please stand as we sing.
Please sit down. We're now going to join in the committal ceremony before we farewell Audrey's coffin to be taken down south and laid to rest. Following these prayers, I think it's Leonie, Ruth, and are going to pray the farewell number that is printed there on your order of service. And then we'll follow the coffin out as members of the family take it. And then after a suitable amount of time, refreshments are going to be served, and we trust that you will all stay and share both in the refreshments. Some of Audrey's favourites have been prepared, and I'm hoping that you'll feel free to share many memories of our dear sister. Well, would you please stand? The Bible reminds us that the Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. Our life is like grass. We flourish like a flower of the field. The wind goes over it, and it's gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life. In your keeping are all those who have departed in Christ. We here commit the mortal body of Audrey Edna Hollins to be cremated. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who died and was buried and who rose again for us, and who shall change our mortal body that it may be like his glorious body. Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now to him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with everlasting joy, to the only wise God, our Saviour, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.
Amen.